Good afternoon, everyone. We're about to start the session, if you'd like to all take your seats. We're going to try and do this in a different way this session, if that's all right, because you've had a number of panel sessions, and you've only actually got one presentation at this session, and that's me. And then after this, we're going to open it up and have a discussion. So we really want to make sure that this is highly interactive. And Christoph, who's my colleague over there, is going to, you're going to run around with a microphone or something. So, yeah. Okay, so I would like to welcome you all to this session. My name is Susie Hargreaves. I'm the Chief Executive of the Internet Watch Foundation in the UK, which is the UK hotline for reporting child sexual abuse content. And I'm going to tell you about a project that we did. We're now going into the third year of a piece of research, which was funded by Microsoft. And I want to kind of tell you about some of the findings so that we can share those with you and some of the learnings. And actually what I really want to do is also share with you some of the challenges of the work, because some of the findings were quite controversial, actually. Some of the ways we described what we found, people didn't like. Some of the issues we uncovered were uncomfortable. And I think it'd be really useful for us to have a discussion about this together. Okay, so I'm also really going to focus on how we're a multi-stakeholder organisation. And I know that I've just come out of a really excellent session on multi-stakeholder working in the field. When it comes to child sexual abuse content and removing it from the internet, you can't actually achieve anything unless you work with all the partners that are involved. So I really want to stress that side of it, and I'll explain a bit about how we work as a multi-stakeholder organisation. But I also want you to know that we're a third of the UK Safer Internet Centre. So a Safer Internet Centre is a partnership, the hotline element, but also an awareness-raising node, which is ChildNet International in the UK, and a professional helpline, which is Southwest Grid for Learning. And in fact, they are partners of the bigger network, InSafe, and there is a stall in the foyer, so please find out about that. And in particular, Safer Internet Day, which happens at the beginning of February each year. And that happens across the whole of the world, and it's not just about protecting young people from accessing criminal content, which is my area of work, which I'm going to talk about. But it's also about finding ways to ensure that young people understand how to keep themselves safe online. Okay, so I'm now going to talk about the specific research, and then we'll stop after, it will only be about 10 minutes, I'm quite a speedy presenter, and then we can really open it up and have a discussion if that's all right. And feel free to really challenge this or to give your opinions and to differ from mine, to disagree. So, okay, so although I work for a technology organisation, I invariably never can use these, so I'm going to apologise in advance. So, why is this not working? Am I holding the wire? Aha, okay, right, okay, so. Okay, so the IWF, that's the Internet Watch Foundation, which I will now call the IWF, because that's what we call ourselves, is the largest European hotline. We're the second biggest in the world after the National Centre for Exploited and Missing Children in the US. And it's our job to go after child sexual abuse material. We're a registered charity in the UK, so we're an entirely independent organisation. That means we're an NGO and not-for-profit. And we work incredibly closely with law enforcement and the online industry. In fact, we're funded by the online industry. And if you see this poster over here, you'll see our members. We have about 120 members, a lot of the biggest internet companies in the world, and they fund us. About 80% of our money comes from them and 20% from the EU as part of the UK Safer Internet Centre. So what do we actually do? Well, in 2014, and we've given you all a copy of our annual report, we assessed about 75,000 reports. Those are reports that came from the public, but also we have powers in the UK to proactively seek content, so we can go out and look for content. So we assessed about 75,000 reports, and of those, 31,266 were child sexual abuse content. Now, a URL could have 1 or 1,000 images. So that doesn't equate to numbers of images. That was the most URLs we've ever brought down, and in fact this year we'll probably we've already exceeded 50,000, so it's going to be a lot more this year. So we also, as well as our core service, which is to work with the internet industry to remove content from the internet, we also conduct research, because we're in a very privileged position in that we have access to these images and these trends and patterns online, so we can actually use that access to inform our operations but to share our findings. And in 2012, we were asked by Microsoft to undertake a really tiny little piece of research, a snapshot into looking at self-generated content on the internet. And in 2015, we recently repeated this exercise, changing the methodology slightly, and we're about to look at the next stage of this research. Okay, so I'm going to tell you quickly about the 2012 study. So we had our content analysts, so we actually have 12 content analysts whose job it is to look at child sexual abuse, assess it, and then take appropriate action. They dedicated some time to each time they found a URL that had child sexual abuse content, to assess whether it was self-generated, and then to note that. So we actually looked at and they had three criteria to look at. So was the content that was assessed self-generated? And was it featuring a young person? And I think it's important to say that we take action on young people aged 18 or under. Okay, that is the definition of a child, aged 18 or under. But we also rarely take actual action on children unless we can absolutely guarantee they are under 18. So this means that the majority of the action we take on children is of very young age groups, because once children go through puberty, it's very hard to assess whether a girl is 13 or 18 or 21. So the majority of the content we take action on, like last year, 80% of the content was of children we assessed to be 10 years or under, and about 4% was of children that we assessed to be under 2. So the first criteria was, is the content self-generated of a young person, so under 18? Is the content being assessed a still image or a video? And does the content being assessed appear on a parasite website? And I'd like to just define that for you. So basically, this is content that has been taken from its original origin and uploaded onto another site. So in most cases, this would mean it would be on a child sexual abuse website. So it may have been a selfie taken by someone at home, shared in school, and somehow it's made its way onto a child sexual abuse website. The combined total time of that study was 47 hours, 47 hours of an analyst's time. And we defined it in 2012 as self-generated content as nude or semi-nude images or videos created by a young person knowingly engaging in erotic and sexual activity. And that's interesting because the definition changed by 2015 and it's changing all the time. And that became one of the most controversial aspects, was around the definitions that we used. The actual full report is available on our website if anyone wants to see it. So in 47 hours, we found 12,224 images that met the criteria, and they broke down to just over 7,000 images and 5,000 videos. And it was on 68 different websites. And the statistic that was picked up most within the media and with all our partners was that 88% of that content had been redistributed from its original location. So basically, once it's out there, it's out there. It's been shared and shared and shared. The conclusions that we made at the time was that it was a very limited snapshot. We were really clear. We just took a really quick look at this. It was a snapshot of what we could find. And that actually we wanted to get the message across that, you know, if your image is out there, it's very hard to control the redistribution of that work, that image. And actually we want to make sure people are aware that it's going to be shared and it will appear on different websites. But there were a number of limitations, because obviously it was only a snapshot. And then also we were very clear that we weren't doing anything to look at the motivation behind the taking of those images. So clearly there were child sexual abuse images, but we weren't looking at whether the victims had been coerced, whether they were groomed, how that had happened. We were simply saying, that's a child sexual abuse image. It's been taken from here and it's been put there. Okay. That was outside of the scope of the study. So in 2015, Microsoft asked us to do the study again. And we did it in a slightly different way. We knew more about the issue, and we actually looked at issues around definitions and how we might actually do it. But we wanted to see if the technology had changed, if the patterns were different. So we looked at a three-month period this time, okay? So we actually looked at 3 months of data based on public reports. So this is the reports that we received from the public. This was actually prior to us having powers to proactively seek content. So we looked at public reports, historic data, and we did do a little bit of proactively sourced content because we had powers to go from a public lead into a proactive situation. So you can see that we captured the content as follows. We wanted to look at the image video category, the site type, whether it's commercial content. There was a discussion about whether content was commercial or not in the previous session. We find that around 25% of the content that we encounter is commercial. That means it's behind a payment barrier. About 75% of it is freely available on the internet. We looked at the hosting location, we assessed the age and gender, and we looked at the original suspected provenance, so the device where it came from. So we wanted to kind of have a sense of had the patterns changed around the technology. So in this time, we defined youth-produced sexual content as nude or semi-nude images or videos produced by a young person of themselves engaging in erotic or sexual activity and intentionally shared by electronic means. Okay, so during this time, we encountered 3,803 images and videos which met the criteria, and 17% of those were of children that we assessed of 15 or younger. So the majority of them were the older age group. But looking at the younger group, and this is actually the controversial finding in terms of what we found, was that 85% of them had been used creating a webcam, and 46% of that was category A or B. Now, in the UK, child sexual abuse images are categorised A to C. A is the worst, C is the least worst. They're all pretty awful. So A and B are the worst types of child sexual abuse images. And the amount of the content on parasite websites, so these would be child sexual abuse websites, was about 89%. And again, the full results of this can be found on our website. Now, the issue of why is the issue of webcams important here is that actually what that meant was a child going into the bedroom on their own without an adult visible anywhere whatsoever and actually doing things on camera which were being recorded. Okay, so we did find that the amount of content on parasite websites had remained static, and that it was simply 17.5% of that was at the younger age group. So it's still the older age group who are taking images of themselves and sharing them, or being coerced or groomed or whatever. But the issue, of, as we say, was of the young children using webcams. So that it raised whole issues around parental supervision, about what children were doing in their bedrooms on their own. And then the issue, which we tried to cover here, was once again, we were looking at what we found as opposed to the motivations behind it. So the truth is that a five-year-old or a six-year-old or a 10-year-old does not go into their bedroom and knowingly engage in sexual activity on a webcam without a level of coercion and exploitation, and that's the reality of it. And we weren't in a position, because we were looking at those images and videos on parasite websites, to understand the original source. Okay, so what can be done about this? Because it did raise loads of questions. You know, is it responsible for us to say children very young going into bedrooms on their own and doing things? And actually, we feel it's really important because people need to understand the risk for their children. We think it's really important that people need to understand that children in their bedrooms, it needs to be age-appropriate access to the internet in their own bedrooms, and they need to understand the risks and be protected. We don't suggest it's one person or one organisation's roles to resolve this. It requires a multi-stakeholder approach. So we need to do a lot to prevent these risks becoming harm. So what we need to do is work really closely with parents and schools, helplines, awareness-raising organisations, and we need to start it much younger. So I don't know about other countries, but in the UK, it's quite difficult to start a conversation with very young children in a school setting about how to keep themselves safe online and the notion of sexualized behavior or whatever. That's a really tricky thing, you know, but actually there's some really clear safety messages which need to be shared. We need to actually work very closely with the companies who provide the services. One of the issues for us is that as it becomes easier and easier to upload videos and new apps come in every single day, it's really hard to make sure that all the internet companies are totally on top of it. So you'll get the bigger companies who will totally engage in the process and look at ways in which they can make their services safer. But actually, it's really difficult to ensure that everybody is totally up to speed. That researchers and academia need to share everything that they can, that they find about this. And that also governments need to take this seriously. The issue of online safety needs to be taken really seriously. So that was our research. I'm really happy to answer specific questions about it, but I wanted to kind of raise a discussion and ask people's opinion about, you know, how do we keep people safe online? When is it appropriate to start the conversations? When, you know, what do we do about self-generated content, about people, you know, how do we master and deal with all that side of things? One of the good things I can say at the end of this, and in fact I've got an information sheet about this, is that a number of times during the last couple of days the issue of technology and hash lists has come up. We're developing a hash list. So basically, I'll just repeat what I said before. Hash list is a digital fingerprint. Each photograph, each image can be given a digital fingerprint. So if you have a unique image, you give it a digital fingerprint, you can then search for all the copies of that photograph. So this is going to be a game changer for us, because it means the majority, it's very, very rare our analysts see new photos or new images or new videos. The majority of what they see are duplicates. So if we can search for a photograph, which we know there are maybe hundreds of thousands of copies out on the internet, and bring those down, then it really is going to be a game changer. And if people want to understand how hash lists work, I'd say I've got an information sheet on that. And that will really help some of this content that we've been seeing, especially the younger ones. If we can identify it, we can hash it. We're working on the video element of hashing now, and then we can actually go out, search for those images, and help protect those young people. Okay, so that's the end of the research, but I'd like to open it up to questions now, please. Thank you. So you can either come here or...
Thank you for this research. I mean, I think this is what we need, more research to have deeper understanding and do and have evidence to base our programs on rather than just intuitions. And I will just disclaim this. I come from the youth at IGF program. I work with youth in Mexico and I have worked with youth at different stages. And my bias, my personal bias, is that I come from a context where self-produced sexual content among youth is used to continue misogyny and to continue adult-centric views in my context. And so we end up in a situation where if you sext, if you send images, you will be judged for doing so. It is not seen from a sex-positive perspective. It is seen at best from a protectionist perspective and at worst, based on a poor view of youth. So my concern is that sometimes in child abuse protection, we can give a lot of food for this type of abuse, a different type of abuse that relates especially to late childhood, right, or teenage. So my question on this is, I mean, I think what you were saying, for example, with people under 10 who go on their own to the room, like that's pretty clear that there is a form of abuse going on there. And I don't know if it was part of your research or if you can answer based on your other work with child abuse. Do you think that this abuse, or to what extent does this abuse happen because of online-based extortion? And to what extent it happens because of the context they're physically living in? Like, maybe are they living in an abusive family, or have they been abducted, or like in the cases that it's clearly not just where you cannot argue that it's a sex positive stance from children.
Okay, so because it's a discussion, I'm going to let some other people answer this, because some of the questions, we've got some experts in the room. So Marie-Law, if that's okay, thanks.
So you have raised many different interesting issues. So I'll answer to the first part of your question regarding teenagers being harassed in some countries. So one way to look at it, some agencies and organizations do think that's the best way to handle, speaking of teenagers, not younger age categories, the best way to handle this new thing going on with self-produced sexual materials is not to criminalize this behavior, because there is an acknowledgement that adolescents are entitled to have a healthy sexual life. Having said that, some countries, from a legal perspective, have accepted that, and as a matter of fact, Austria just recently adopted a law, and it will come into force January 1st, legalizing consensual sexting for teenagers over 14 years old. So that's an example, I would say, in the legal field of a best practice of a country that is accepting the idea of adolescents having consensual, blah, 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 sexual relationship. But from a cultural perspective, we have to acknowledge that in most of the countries in the world, there's still a resistance in accepting, you know, having adolescents engage in a sexual relationship. I mean, from a cultural, religious perspective, it's still a challenge in most of the countries in the world, in Africa, in Asia. I mean, so if from a cultural or religious perspective, it's very hard to accept it, then on the legal front, it's going to be even harder, because the legal field follows, you know, it's. So that's a couple of comments I would like to make related to your point.
My name's David Cake from Electronic Frontiers Australia. Just recently, actually, we had a year or so ago, we had a law, not an Australian federal law, but a state law, and I contributed to that, the discussion around it and the inquiry that created it, where in one of the states of Australia, in Victoria, and hopefully we will be a model for, you know, and spread. They created, looked at the issue of sexting and you know, you said youth created sexual material, and they distinguish it between it's a different issue to child sexual abuse material, and they've created a separate law where essentially if the, you know, the exchange would be between people who legally could be considered to sexually consent, then that's by itself okay, the people who would sexually consent would not be able to be published material. So to 16-year-olds, for example, they might legally be able to have sex, and by the law they can legally have sexual explicit material of each other, but they can't publish that widely. And then they created a separate criminal, so they removed some images from child pornography law, child sexual abuse material law, but they then brought in a separate offence for non-consensual sharing of those images. So you have to sort of show that there's consent for that to be shared, and I think actually if you've non-consensually shared it, you can still actually be prosecuted under child sexual abuse material if you have nothing to do, you know, if you can't prove that you had consensual. But there's also a separate thing, but it means that and part of the problem here is that for when you're in this, I mean, I know one of the groups here is actually saying no grey areas, but it is a grey area because it requires much more complex understanding, it requires much more context for teenagers than it does for you know, children younger than that. And within that teenage context, the child pornography law is a big blunt instrument where sometimes you need something much more targeted that looks at the consent and things in and who and what and the history in more detail. And that's so that's our experience in Australia. We've created a separate law, and I'm hoping that will spread to be a model that is adapted more widely, where you treat the two issues separately.
Thank you. It would be great to hear from perspectives from maybe Africa or other countries, or great, and also from young people as well. So if anybody wants to kind of talk about it, you know, I know that, you know, in terms of the older age group, so in the UK, because we can't only take action if they're we know they're under 18, we've set up a relationship with the NSPCC, which is the biggest child charity, where if they can confirm the child is under 18, so 17, we then can take action to have it removed. But and also we have a revenge porn helpline now in the UK as well. So for people whose you know, consensual images and videos have then been used for revenge, we have legislation now, and we have a helpline as well. So I'm going to take a question there, Christoph, and then we'll take maybe some other perspectives. Yes, sir, over there. So.
Yeah, I wanted to share this perspective you said from Africa. My name is Alex Gakuru. I'm the executive director of Code IP Trust, a Kenyan nonprofit, and in the middle of implementing a youth online safety that is actually funded by Google. But I'm not speaking on behalf of Google, but these experiences I've had running that program, a pilot involving a few schools. What has been my experience has been is this a very, very new area. Nobody has been tackling it. It's been a vacuum. Forget about gray. It's just been a vacuum. Parents have been afraid to discuss the issue. It's been a taboo in most of our African society to discuss even sex. So even educating about sex in itself in the first place is another complicated issue. Now, we also are in the civil society, social movement sphere, where we are very sensitive about freedom of expression. And we are aware even developed nations have used this wonderful theme of child online protection to sneak in censorship and suppress, create webs that they go and pull in that one. Now, what I want to share is also a paper that you will find interesting that questions the role of legislation, government, in terms of protecting children. It's by Fordham Urban Law Journal, volume number 28 of the year 2000. It talks about, is COPPA a cop-out, the Child Online Privacy Protection Act, as proof that parents, not government, should be protecting children's interests on the internet. What this paper goes ahead and argues is the problem and the challenges the US underwent in approaching it, in having legislation to protect kids, and how all these laws were overturned until they have to end up with a law that protects child privacy online. And it goes ahead and start arguing that I think it's parents who are failing on parenting, you know, and then they're trying to turn to all manner of technology and laws and everything, but probably it's proof of parents failing in parenting. And if government are the ones that are going to raise kids and who the kids meet online, then why isn't there a law as to who the kids are going to meet in the estate, in school, who they're going to talk to? Because equally, there should be another law about who the kids will talk to. So the fundamental question here, I think we need to look at it and start focusing on the people we ignore the most as a parent, and start telling them, we know we are all busy, but then you must do your parenting job and start speaking to your kids. That is a principle. So as we look at all the other measures, technological, legal, you know, whatever they might be, we need to address that fundamental question. Secondly, we need not demonize the internet because other people are using it as a means of trying to show how terrible the internet is. It's not the internet's problem. And so the third thing is we must create what is called a peer. To peer is the most effective way of behavioral change. So if the kids are given some nice framework where they become ambassadors of good internet use, then even in the UK where you're having problems raising that issue, you will find the kids learning about the problems of having their images up to when they get older and the internet never forgets something they sent when they were young. experiences of people who lost jobs because of somebody Googling their social media and finding something they said when they were kids. Then they start learning that they need to have the digital footprint clear, their identity, and many of them are actually changing their behavior. And so if you created that sort of a club, kind of an activity, and ambassadors, they will talk to their peers and you start to have a bigger impact than the top down, clamping down legal and whatever, and parents also, because as multi-stakeholders, having their role as the guiding one. And the entire campaign must be led.
That's great advice, very similar to the Safer Internet Day and lots of us are working on. So fantastic points there. And I think people probably want to bring up about the parents. So we've got one, yeah, over here, and then you, sir. So.
That's a great point. Michael Kaiser from the National Cybersecurity Alliance in the United States. Just a great point about the parents. And first of all, I think your research is great, and I just want to say thank you for that.
Thank you.
We had a corollary in the United States to look at those, to get a better sense of what our young people are doing in this regard. I think this is the kind of thing we have to try to understand, whether this is becoming like a normal behavior for kids, or is it somehow kids who are more at risk? I mean, we don't have all the answers on that, but we need to look at even more data, I think. So congratulations for sort of breaking the ice and bringing this issue. I think you all deserve a lot of credit for that, so I appreciate that. So we just ended Cybersecurity Awareness Month. Happens in a lot of places in the world, started in the United States with a program we helped found. But we did some research with parents about rules they have in their households around some cybersecurity issues, which I think are directly relevant here. And I think it's really interesting because I think parents are a part of the legislative body when we talk about kids, right? We talk about legislation, but you know, parents legislate, right?
Yeah.
In their own homes. Some are dictators, but some might be more cooperative. But what we found was kind of distressing, and we were a little surprised. So we asked about some different sets of rules. First of all, we asked about having the talk, which is, something we're all interested in. And a lot were having the talk, like 75% were having the talk. But we asked things like, do you have rules around allowing devices to be used in the bedroom after a certain time? Only 25% of parents had rules about that, right? I mean, this is directly related to this kind of issue. And there's like, you know, you can triangulate, you know, from that kind of, you know, rule to this kind of result. And I think we haven't done enough work. I think it's a challenge for all of us in the online safety space. I think we have good ideas for what we think parents should be doing. There was another one, 60% didn't even allow, didn't limit screen time per day. Didn't limit during the hours during the day which the device could be used. They didn't limit password sharing. There are all these rules that we think are kind of fundamental to online safety that parents should be teaching, and they're not adopting them. And so we have a disconnect between our messaging to parents and parents adopting those things. And I think that's a serious gap which could address, not all of this issue, but certainly a substantial part of this issue.
So do you have any ideas about how to bridge that gap?
I think we have to do more work because we've been promulgating these messages to parents and to kids for a long time, right? I think, and somehow they're not getting through. So we can't just have a good idea about what the rules should be unless we talk more to parents about how they're struggling to put those rules in place. And that's, I think, where there's a big gap.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Edmund Chung here. So following up on what David was saying, and actually, first of all, this is a great study. I congratulate you on it, and this is very timely. I remember a few years ago, probably 2009, this was one of the topics that was first brought up at one of the IGF settings, and youth produced sexually explicit content. And it's kind of a big not like and problematic, and I think Marion mentioned earlier in saying that, you know, cultural sensitivities make it very difficult to, you know, not only decriminalize the issue but even talking about the issue. And I wanted to ask David, because I think that's a great idea. This is a topic that I've been running some training for internet governance, and this is a topic that is I usually bring up as a very tough topic to tackle. And I think the experience from Australia is very interesting. Not only are you decriminalizing, but also in some ways protecting the right of certain young people, by the time they can do it, they can also see themselves do it in some ways. But the more interesting thing, though, I'm curious if there is any since the passing of the law, has there been any cases? Because once we get there, there's a lot of gray areas, right? I mean, you provided consent. You might have provided consent for the first time you share it. You know, how do you take back that consent? In a relationship, I may be giving you the consent, but after the relationship, I probably want to take back the consent. How does that work? And are there cases, because we quickly run into very difficult cases in terms of defining whether consent was established or not for sharing. I think it's a great direction, but I'm curious what the experience is actual, you know, with the law in actual action.
I don't know if there have been any cases. It's actually for a state I don't live in, so I haven't been following it that closely. The results, and I also want to say Australian law remains a total mess because we have state and federal law, which say totally different things. Our federal law is incredibly overbroad. But my understanding of the law that they passed is that there's no way to revoke possession of an image, but no matter if you legitimately obtained it, that gives you no right to share. Right. So, and in fact, sharing it becomes a criminal act. So, but there's no. I don't think there's any provision to revoke consent for possession of an image once you already have it. And I think that would. Yeah, they'd have to pass a whole different and very difficult to enforce law, I think, to really have that happen. So.
To build on what David just said, the revenge porn bill, Susie mentioned, is a similar thing. It's very recent in the UK. So basically what is criminalized is the act of sharing without consent. You're not criminalizing the producing with consent in a private relationship, but as when it goes out without the consent, and it's the dissemination that is being criminalized. And in light of the findings, I think that's the way to go. Because then you lose control of the material, and it's copied and reproduced, and it ends up in collections of sexual predators.
One of the things, I'm pretty sure that there's some provision to deal with it in a less aggressive criminal ways when the people who've committed the act are themselves underage. So basically they're worried about images being like passed around a high school sort of community, and the best way to deal with it is not necessarily to threaten, 15-year-olds with jail. So there is some flexibility in how it's applied.
Okay, so we've had talked a lot about the difference between self-generated content, which people have consented to in some kind of way, and then there's quite a difference between a 5 or 6-year-old being groomed or exploited, coerced, and going into their room and having images taken of them. Can I just go through this? Thanks. So I wondered if anybody had any points about parents the issues that we've talked about, parents' responsibility, about the legislation, about the how do we get the messaging across, so anybody's got anything they want to share or want to challenge, please feel free to go for it. I'd love to hear from some young people as well. So, thank you.
Sorry, I raised my hand before you said the word parents. And I wanted to go to the point of commercialization of the content, because when you talked about the methodology, you said 20% of the content was assumed to be commercial, and you said that means it's behind a payment barrier. And my question is, wouldn't you think that there is more commercialization? Because we know that there is a phenomenon where, on the one hand, images are swapped between people, not like sharing and consent, but handing over an image and getting something in exchange. And in many, many cases, the images are used as a fee to get access to more images. So you need to produce a new image, to show a new image, to get into a forum, and then you have access to lots and lots of other images. And I would say this is also kind of a commercialization, and therefore I was questioning a little bit the 20% that you mentioned. Could you explain that?
Yeah, and you make a really good point. So, I mean, I guess what we, the reason we make a separation between commercial content and content that's freely available is as part of the European Financial Coalition, which we're very active in. Actually, what you have is, if it's behind a payment barrier, it's normally an organised crime situation. Whereas if so, people who are behind a payment barrier might be selling drugs, child sexual abuse, whatever you like, you know what I mean, hitman, whatever. Whereas actually, when it comes to the sharing of content, that's about behaviour, collectors. It's a different kind of motivation, and that's why we separate them. But you're certainly absolutely correct that there is a bartering process, not only in terms of I've got a better collection than you and peer-to-peer, but certainly some of the very worst sites, you can't get on them unless you submit unique content. So you're absolutely right. It's very complex. So we just separate it in terms of payment barrier, because we deal with what's on the open internet, and we don't have authority to go beyond a payment barrier, because we would then be paying for criminal content. So, but you're right to raise that. You're absolutely right. So, yeah.
Sorry for stepping away from five-year-olds. I promise this is the last comment, but it's to respond to Michael, I think is your name. I'm not a parent. Also, I'm not sure if I'm young. I'm well past 18. And I also don't lead like a national initiative. So I don't know if this is going to be useful at all, but I do think that we face the same problem, which is how to have impact in our communications and advocacy beyond setting the good rules. Like, how do we get people to brush their teeth 3 times a day beyond telling them that? And something that has worked at the micro level in my context was with parents, not talking about their responsibilities, but opening the space for their fears. Again, this is not like a 2-hour workshop. 2-hour workshops are basically good for nothing, in my opinion. But it was like in a process of 4 sessions, 4-hour sessions, 4 times meeting with a group of parents. It was not framed as what they should be doing with their kids online, but like addressing their fears in not understanding what kids were doing with technology. This gathering began because of a girl who was almost a victim of child trafficking because of Facebook activity. And this brought the parents together, and it was about first them having a chance to speak about what they feared. What they feared would happen if they weren't good parents, or what their kids would get themselves into, and then understanding like the basics. And after this process, we can say that basically 80% of the participants, 3 months afterwards, had reported that they had introduced new rules and new conversations in their home. Now, this is a micro level. And working on this with youth, I have a less experience with this, but rather than framing it in the sort of media literacies curricula, we started working with sexual and reproductive rights groups, rather than like the people who talk about ICT, because their interests will go to other stuff. They will go to YouTube and stuff. But when we speak with people who have been working on how to use condoms and how to get people to ask about the pill and things like that, like that was a more natural link to the discussion on sexting than the technology side. But then again, that's in my context in Mexico.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Oh, you, yeah. And who's that?
I'm David from Dockers Foundation. Indeed, I want to share a very interesting piece of information with a partner organization in China. Indeed, they got a research done by a China partner called China National Youth Palace Association of Media Literacy and Research Center. They have research done last year for around 20,000 children who is aged 3 to 14 years old, and with their parents. They got research findings on how their parents doing on making some kind of guidance and the consent with their children themselves. The research found out that is around 61.7% parents have not screening for the use of the app on their children's mobile and tablet, and 67.7% parents have no promises with their children on what kind of time knots and those kinds of materials can be can we browse online? There will be like to show another fact that children and parents have low this kind of consent and have been done, and lack of the guidance on parents' perspective on doing the things like this. On the other sense, I would like to design this kind of information to be shared as I'm also a youth, but I'm not presenting the children aged under 18, but as I've just also checked with the children under 18, they are using the apps like SlapCheck, but not like us using those Skype or WhatsApp with the record to be checked. They can share the information in SlapCheck that can't be chased, that can be effaced in a very short period of time. If we are using our kids or our youngest generation is using these kind of apps in the sense of communication, it's hard to check out whether they are using this platform to share the information which is not appropriate. So how to tackle the problems? I really appreciate the lady and the funds to talk about the media literacy education to be done in the curriculum. In the education is one of the methods to be done on educating kids to be following those kinds of rules and regulation and self-disciplines on how they can use the internet in a proper way. I think it is only the better way to be run in a sense instead of doing so those kinds of like law and enforcement stuff in a sense, because children and youth to get self-discipline on the issue is the main problems on the sense. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go one, two, and then three.
Okay. I have a question and I have a comment, suggestion. Yeah, yeah. So let me start with the suggestion. We are trying to... We're trying to develop a curriculum for children from KG 1 onwards that will help the child to be safe online from the childhood itself. The curriculum will have three dimensions: child and the parent and the teacher. The parent also have to be educated along with the child that how do you parent a cyber child. So this is one thing which you're working on, so it's an ambitious project and taking care about. Now, I have a question, basically. That normal sextortion is happening in a way that, okay, I have your image. If you don't do what I say, I'll publish on the internet. This is what normal sextortion happening. But we have a couple of issues that happen in India. It is, I call it, instead of blackmail, I call it white mail or gray mail, for example. What is that? The person will come back and say, I already published your images online, and here is the link. And there's a username and password. If you don't do what I say, I don't do anything. After 1 week, the username and password will be removed, and the URL will be publicly available. Do you come across, because in this one, she cannot go back to the police, because he don't do anything. Even you caught him red-handed, still, if you don't do anything, the images will be published automatically. Okay, so have you come across with this kind of any issues, and did you have any way to handle this kind of thing?
Right. Ada, did you have a response to that one? Yeah, okay. Do you want to just respond to that one, and then we'll take a point from here and from over there as well? And great, perfect, thanks. So.
Thank you, Susie. Well, actually, I'm Arla from the Dutch Hotline. We have a lot of reports happening this way in very various ways of being extortioned. Actually, it is illegal. Even if it's behind a password or whatever, you cannot extort somebody. So you can go to the police. The fact is that 90% of the time, you will never ever hear from it again. Another 10% do publish it online, so then you're in big trouble. We always say that you shouldn't pay, because they will always ask you for more money. It's extortion, and extortion is that, that's just there in the world. Another thing about what I wanted to add on how to educate the children, I think we have a big problem here, because the thing is, I think we're the only ones in this room who actually realize what can be done on the internet. And we probably, I hope so, are the ones who make our equipment safe with passwords, strong passwords, because we know what will be happening online if we don't. Most of the parents, most of the normal people don't use strong passwords, don't have virus scanners on their equipment. They're not safe at all. Now, this is grown-up people who know that A has a result to B. And children, youngsters, they don't have any clue of what might happen, and they are even more thinking like, it will never ever happen to me. So what can we do? We have parents thinking, it will not happen to me. having to educate kids who are thinking it will not happen to me. So I think the challenge is there.
That's a really great point, actually. So, yes, please.
Yeah. During this year's Safer Internet Day, we conducted a very successful experiment, and we decided, you know what, we want to pretend we don't know the answers to this problem. And so we got 10 schools, students, teenagers from 10 schools. We got them on a round table. We had parents, we had teachers, we had even government, policymakers, Ministry of Education, and we had all of them there. And we just asked a simple question. What is it about the internet that you love, that you want to be on? And the kids were amazing. The sort of things they said, they wowed everybody. Things we thought we knew, we found the kids knew better. Then we asked them to think, what are the bad things on this internet that you'd want to be protected? They said a lot of amazing things. And then thirdly, we asked them, what do you think should be done to keep you safe so that the good things you want online can continue and the bad things are protected? They had a myriad of answers. Some of them said, parents can do nothing. We can do what we want, and the parents are there. And they say, we can change. And if parents think they can follow us on Facebook, they join Facebook, we quit. We go to another app. If they join this app, we get out because we don't want them where we are, which is what happens in real life. Now, the moral of the story, or the to cut it short, is that I think this dialogue is best when you get all these people around there. It maintains the currency, so you discuss current issues, and you get amazing solutions to complex problems. You learn along the way, and you find even parents appreciating what's happening, and it makes it an environment where it's not the top-down, father knows all, trying to, you don't become a net nanny, trying to dictate, and the kids feel they are heard, and it becomes a dialogue that can continue, and it becomes a very light conversation and interesting, and we found that to be extremely interesting, and I thought maybe I should share that experience.
Yeah, that's a fantastic example. Thank you so much. So, Florian.
Hello, everybody. I'm Florian, and I'm 19, so not 18, but a little older. I want to make a point back going to the parents and why we maybe do not reach out to them and why it's hard to communicate. I would say my parents know what can happen if you don't use a condom when having sex. They don't know what will happen if I share my very private pictures over Snapchat or Facebook or WhatsApp. I think that's the key issue, and I'll make a risky prediction. I would say when my generation is starting to having kids, and some people already started having kids, this issue will fix itself by a certain amount, because then there is an understanding from the parents, but it has to be an understanding by experience. It's hard to teach parents what can happen. They have to experience it. So I say in a few years' time, for the young parents, it's not an issue. Yeah,
so you think it's just a temporary issue, really? And
well, not really, because the technology is also changing. So when I'm having kids and I don't know how many years, if, then there are new apps and new technologies that I don't understand. But there is a slight chance that the technology doesn't change that much, that the logic behind is the same, that I will understand what can happen to my kids.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a question, because my kids, I've got big kids, so 17 and 23, and they just accept different modes of behavior as well. So it's not just about the older age group. It's, I mean, as you say, it's the consensual thing, but they actually think certain things are just not a big deal. That sort of send me really crazy. So when my daughter was meeting one of her close friends' boyfriend recently, I said, have you met him before? And she said, no, but I've seen his penis. So, you know, it's and without it, without even like, you know, yeah, okay, right, fine. You know, like, and I'm, you know, so, but anyway, so here we go, yeah.
I'm a bit skeptic of that point. Thank you. I'm a bit skeptic of relying on that you didn't know better or you couldn't foresee your future, because I think even us as adults make that mistake often. And, I mean, for example, when you say something, then you go, oh, I shouldn't have said that. Is it truly that nobody took the time to train you and make you aware of what was in your future? I mean, we all make decisions based on what our present is. And, like, when I was 15 years old and I was posting things of myself online, I was thinking of the current authorities, which were my parents. But now I'm 10 years later. I still make decisions that maybe when I'm 35, I will be like, I shouldn't have done that. And I don't think I would call myself ignorant. I mean, I think I reflect a lot about these things. And I understand that the framing is, let's try to get people to think about their future, if it's possible. But even if you try to foresee your future, there will be things that when you're assessing in real life at the moment, it's not going to be like that. And then you're going to say, well, they're stupid, they're ignorant. I mean, is that really what we think of people who uploaded a picture of themselves naked, that they're ignorant or that they didn't think about the future?
Yeah, hi, Susie. Jim Prendergast. I'll preface it by saying the father of a 12-year-old girl and a 10-year-old boy. So picking up on what you said, Susie's given the youth plenty of notice. So this question is for you guys and you guys only. The parent telling the child what to do or what not to do, as you alluded to as well, you're not going to listen to us. I mean, we're your parents. You're not supposed to listen to us. I think that's part of the cycle of growing up. We all went through it. I guess the question I have for you is, when it comes to issues like this, who do you listen to? I mean, is it solely making the mistakes on your own? Or do you actually listen to your friends, your teachers? Are there other folks that, when they talk to you about these issues, that it sort of resonates and you say, okay, maybe I'll give that a shot, but it's definitely not my parents speaking to me. So I'll toss that out there to see if anybody wants to take it up.
Florian, do you want to respond to that? Yeah? Okay. And anybody else wants to respond to that? Great. We've got, we're going for younger people right now. So one second.
Okay. It's certainly a very good question. And I remember when I was in secondary school, there was this love track where we learned about condoms and sex and all that stuff. And that were random dudes, basically, trainers that I didn't know before, that came from the big city and I'm from the countryside. And they weren't my teachers. I had no relationship, no contact to them before and not after them. So I could talk to them about my private fears without having the fear that they will tell anybody I know, because they were not in my social connection base, basically. So I think, trainers that just go around the countries and inform people is probably a part of the solution. Not the whole, but certainly a part.
Have you got could we just take the young person and then after.
Yes. Answering to your question, I think what our parents tell us, it's of course very important, but I think like what we see in our schools and what happened to other people in our environment, we see what happened to the other people, and if I like accidentally send a nude to anyone, I know that I would take that risk, but that's how we know how it's danger, the danger of posting a pic of a sexual contest in a sexual contest.
I'm Haley, and I'm like youth as well. To respond to your like questions, I would say definitely peers play an important role in like influencing like my decision. But at the same time, actually parents play a more important role to me. But in terms of two main conditions, the first one is how knowledgeable my parents are, because my father is engineer and he know a lot, and if he show me that like he really know a lot about internet, and he's like show some like tell me some evidence in doing some like if the consequences of some wrongdoings or whatever, he's like knowledgeable in this, and I will believe in them. And the second condition is that the relationship between parents and children, and like for most of like those naughty kids, why they are not listening to the parents is because their relationship is not that close, and that's the main problem for some of this like problem. They're like trying to like play around with the other kids, or sometimes their friends are not that like good, and that's why to cause this kind of problem. So I think like if we like the role of parents are really important. I think we have to address the two conditions I address. Yeah, thanks.
I just want to answer to this question. If you're interested in the behavior of teenagers online and how they deal with privacy and social media, I highly recommend the book research of Dana Boyd. She did a book called It's Complicated, which is about, she interviewed hundreds of teenagers about their use of social media and so on and privacy, and it's really interesting. But if you're looking for a single sort of simple answer to how you know, how teenagers deal with privacy and so on, well, the book's called It's Complicated. That's a bit of a giveaway. So.
Well, to your question, Jim, even though we know as parents that some of what we're going to say won't be listened to, it's our obligation as a parent to say it and to sort of discuss it with our kids. I mean, we can't, and this is parenting, huh? This, to your point. Parenting in the 21st century is much harder maybe than parenting in the 20th century. I don't know about that. But, and to your point about your father knowing most parents know very little about technology, and the kids are wiser in terms of technological knowledge, some. But it doesn't mean that parents can't guide you because they have more experience. They know better because they're older. So you can teach them how to use technology, but they can't teach you how to behave, because as you said, it's not about technology, it's about human behavior. Yeah. Offline, online, it's human behavior. It's the decision you take using the technology, but after all, it's just a decision you take to click or not click. It's in your brain, in your heart. It's not about the technology. The technology evolves. Crime is going to evolve. So, again, parents have to be around. Peers have to be around. Family has to be around. And we all have to discuss those issues.
Okay, thank you. We've got 1, 2, 3. But before we hear from people who've spoken before, is there anybody who hasn't spoken yet who really wants to speak, who's got anything to say? Okay, great. Can we just take some new voices and then we'll pick up? Okay, so please. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Felix from netmission.asia. And to bring in some perspective from Asia, we are usually very subtle in talking about sex education. And the sex education that I received in high school, we couldn't hear about anything about sexual organs at all. And I never received any sex education from a parent at all. So I think that from an Asian perspective, a lot of these youth-produced sexual materials tend to be produced in a really private setting, and we won't even discuss with our friends that we produce such content. So I think that it's really, really an issue for us to identify such images that, because for average parents, if they know that their kids are conducting these youth-produced images, they would certainly do something about it, at least. But we're talking about situations that none of us know that the kids are producing such materials, and I think it is a concern that we have to address as well.
Right, so that was a really interesting point. So, so we're going to go 1, 2, and then 3. Okay, so thank you.
Edmund Chung. I thought the interchange right now is really good, and it really highlights what we hear in IGF and what we talk about multi-stakeholder approach, because it's not so much about, you know, adults teaching, you know, or teaching kids or saying you need to do this or not do that, nor is it about kids knowing everything. You know, I think one of the conclusions that we really need to draw from kind of this conversation is all the people, including myself, who are creating training materials for kids, we need to remember that from the very beginning, we need to engage kids to in the production of those materials, how this type of thinking needs, you know, can be conveyed to them. So that's really, you know, I think one of very important thing. And the gentleman over there, I one of the things I always tell, you know, when I do some training, is that you guys actually know better than you know, some of the experts, because you lived through, you know, in grade school, lived through the Facebook, right? You're the first generation that does that, and you think that, you know, if you think that you know by the time you're parents you will know everything, that's probably also wrong, because I'm hoping that at least not everyone is a victim, right? So you have to learn from others as well. I think, you know, that's one thing, you know, one of the takeaways really, you know, even when we not just in how we conduct the training sessions or education sessions, but right from the beginning of designing the course or designing the materials, we need to engage those who are quote-unquote experts who have lived through that process as well. So I think, you know, that's one of the takeaways I have pretty clear.
It's about behavioral change, and I think they always stand better when they speak by themselves. So there is a website I have been following since 2005, and I still find it one of the most powerful things in terms of behavioral change. And this is sadd.org. www.sadd.org. This is Students Against Destructive Decisions. And they pick topic issues on various aspects, and this creates a club where the dynamics of the issue, maybe it could be drugs, it could be tomorrow, it could be an issue on technology, it could be on anything and decisions. So unless maybe we create an environment where the kids can discuss the issues they want, because he may say what he's saying at the back there right now because he's not yet got a kid, but the day he gets his first kid, people get transformed. I have had some telling me, the moment I got a kid, now I have to worry about protecting my kid. But before that, they wanted all the freedom. So I think the idea is to like push them into something of that sort so that they can now start making decisions. So even when you're out of the picture, because they'll never listen to you as a parent, or at least they'll be rebellious, it's part of the growing up, then you at least have a chance of saving them before they go too far in the wrong direction. Thanks.
Fantastic. I'm going to, yeah.
Yeah, so please. I just want to add a couple of things. One is, I think there was a comment earlier about parents, you know, aren't doing the right things in security, and I think it's true. Most people actually know what they're supposed to be doing but don't do it, right? So I don't think that they don't know. I think they don't implement it. And I think that, to your point, that I have some confidence in the generational issue too. I mean, generations do change things. Some of us know that, you know, in the 1960s, if you were caught smoking pot, people told you it was the end of the world. And by 2015, it's a different world when it comes to marijuana, at least in the United States. So, you know, there are shifts. And I think the other point, just a couple quick points I'd make here too. One is, two things. One is we got to cut parents some slack too, because when we did our survey, again, like I said, you know, a lot of parents felt, and this is where the kids come in, this is your challenge to young people. 60% of the parents we asked said they knew everything that their kids were doing online. Now we know, yeah, so you hear me. So there's not a conversation that's happening the other way, right? So, you know, it's hard to parent when you think I got it under control, but no one's helping you understand what you don't know. So I think that's an important challenge to young people, because, you know, you are exploring the technology and having the conversation two ways. It's not just about parents, it's about kids saying, here's what I do online, this is my online life, this is what we're doing, these are the apps we're using. It's really important for them to know, because clearly, in at least the United States, they don't. And the other thing I would say is that we're all in this together. And the example that I would give is this. As a parent, right, when I finally teach my child to drive, I will probably have been driving for 15 or 20 or maybe even more years, right? I have a lot of experience driving, so when I get behind the, you know, and try to teach my child to drive, I have a ton of experience. We are both, parents and children, are the first generation using this technology. We're using it together for the first time. None of us know the rules, really, when it comes down to it, right? It's not like I have 20 years of experience using the technology to teach my child how to use the technology. So we're all in this together, I think, is part of the issue here, and we have to figure out how to do that a little bit better, although parents, I feel, always feel like they have the responsibility to know it. So we have that challenge, too. Let's leave it at that.
Thank you. Florian, and then we've got a comment down here. So.
Okay, first I want to comment on what the young man from Asia said. He was talking about that... parents would do something about it if they know that their kids would send a nude to social media and social networks. Very good point, because there is actually a problem where we should start tackling the society in general, because what's wrong with sending nudes? I mean, it's sexy, it's exciting, and it's exploring. I mean, it's fun. So why shouldn't I do it? The problem is that, as we just heard, I would never tell my parents, especially not when I'm younger, because they will try to stop me from doing it. Because it's always about all the concern. It's, and this topic, it's never about the positive side. It's about exploring them myself. So there's really a deeper issue we should maybe also start to tackle with in the workshops and the trainings people do with parents, that it's also a good thing and not only a bad thing. And maybe to come back to your example of the car driving, as a parent you also have 15, 20, even longer experience in sexual interaction. So you also should know that it can be exciting if you do uncommon stuff and stuff that other people don't know about. So there is some special thing in sending nudes without parents knowing. So that's a problem we have to tackle in the society and not with education about how to prevent sending nudes. It's deeper.
Good afternoon. I'm JD from Hong Kong, and I want to talk about is that I don't think everything that the children do do on online is really known by their parents, because as I know, many of my friends, they have a lot of IG accounts, and some of their IG accounts was just do not allow their parents to follow because they just. I think it's a kind of they have a feeling that they want to leave some spaces. They don't want all the things that their parents can know about it. Because I have asked my friends why they don't let their families or their parents to follow their IG accounts. They just simply say that there's nothing they can't know, but I just don't want it because it. The photo I post is just about my school life. Maybe it is not very related to my family life, so I want to separate them into two different maybe accounts to handle those things. And about maybe is it really the teens and. You say that the teens will know what they are doing and they will know what is the result of posting some video. It is a very typical example in East Asia. There is an app which is just like a social network and you can post video on it. And there's a lot of videos which is containing some sexual meaning posed by some young people just because they want to accumulate a certain number of views in that apps. And due to the poor management of the apps, there's a lot of video arose and it cannot be deleted. So I think it is a very typical example which explained that not every teenagers really understand or really know what is the result of it. And it also raises out another problem. In Hong Kong, there's no normal lessons which is talking about those issues. They just, maybe we have just some irregular talk which is about those what you can or you can't do in the online in our school. So I just wanted to ask what program or they can carry out regularly to make the education about those become more efficient.
Okay, thank you. That was really interesting. Thanks a lot. We're going to take another point here, and then we're going to start wrapping it up. So you've not spoken, so I'd like you next to speak. And then before we wrap it up, if anybody's got a really burning, important thing they have to say, you're going to be given an opportunity. But otherwise, we're going to take two more speakers, okay? Thank you.
Just as you were saying, not to cut some slack for
to parents. Sorry, I don't know the phrase in English, but I just want to say we need to do the same with youth. I guess I'm old enough to cringe when I read comments on Ask FM or on Secret, but I'm also young enough to remember what it's like to be able to go on an online chat at age 10 before you know how to keep a secret. So I guess even I'm in an awkward position where I'm not old and I'm not young either, but at the same time I see that older people really get frustrated and have like create problems out of youth behaviors that I'm not sure are problematic. And I think we're all on the same side. We all want young people to flourish and to live the lives they wanted to live, and we don't want to see them harmed. And that's why we are here. We want them to have access to the technologies that changed their lives so that their lives will change for good as well. And so that people who are at risk today will not be even more at risk because of technology. But at the same time, when we're trying to protect children online, what harm are we creating for them? I mean, I've sat across cyber police members who openly admit they keylog their kids and read every night every single thing they wrote. They're taking away their privacy. And, you know, privacy is needed when you're growing up to develop your social skills and your assessments. So I know that this guy has good intentions, and I doubt that he wants to see his kids unable to do stuff when they're older, but do we really think collectively that keylogging and reading everything and being promoting surveillance of kids is the way to go about it? And then again, I mean, we never really spoke about the five-year-olds who right now are being abused and they're being kidnapped and they're suffering a lot, and they're not getting the start of life that they deserve. And because we're focusing all of our collective effort on teenagers who are sexting, because that's what's closer to us, we are not putting this effort into doing things right by the kids who are not doing okay today. So just as we should cut parents some slack, I think we should cut some slack to youth as well. They will be okay. We are okay. And we should focus on those who are not okay, because technology is not necessarily making things better for them.
So I wanted to follow up from the thing that sending nudes is awesome, because like that's like a healthy way of exploring your sexuality. Like, we should be building a kind of environment where there's an attitude that sexuality is okay and sending nudes is okay. Like, we can still see, even with like adult celebrities and the nudes are leaked, and people are shaming the victim and not the one who like hacked their computer or like is like sharing the pictures, but the victim for healthy sexual expression. And I think that's a big problem in our society.
Thank you very much. So, anybody who hasn't spoken yet, who wants to say something? Anybody who's got a burning last thing? Yes, I know. So, anyone else got to say, hang on, wait, we got a new voice here. I'm going to have to give priority to a new voice, okay?
Hi, I'm Juliana. So, you're talking about the views. Unfortunately, we live the culture of views. What I can do to be more famous, what I can do to be more sexy. People need to love me, so I can post a photo, then I can be regretted tomorrow with 35 or 25. So we need to think about the parents too. It's in-house you can learn this stuff. It doesn't matter what the people can say of your nudes. It's safe, and it's safe to send. It's natural. It's okay. But you need to think. It's enough for you, just send some photos. You have the risks to get on the internet online. In Brazil, we have a very famous kid, the Brazilians know MC Melody. And her dad posts very sexy photos, and she have only 8 years old. She's very famous in Brazil singing some songs with sexual content. And the parents don't do anything. She's very, very famous here. she and her sister. She have 80 years old, and her sister have 10, I guess. And they are so, she dressed like a woman, but she's a kid. He have followers to treat her like a woman. She dresses like little, I can't talk ever, it's so complicated. So we need, really need to think about it, what we can do with this kind of parents. It's okay, if I will a parent one day, I will teach my kid, blah, blah, but, and this father, he posted a sex photo of his kid, and everybody says, oh, she's cute, oh, she's sexy. 8 years old of girl? No.
Right, I'm going to actually stop, okay, because it's a matter of personal pride to me that I've never gone over time on a session, and I'm not about to start now. So, okay, so I think this has been a great discussion. I just can't thank you all enough for really engaging in the subject. I know we focused on the older age group, but that was because that's what people here wanted to talk about. Obviously, we're really aware that there's a difference between the very young, very vulnerable children who do need to be protected, and we need to do what we can. Really interesting discussion. Absolutely loved the range of views. Can't thank you enough. And in particular, I really want to thank all the young people who spoke. And I know for some people it's hard and it's tough. It really takes guts to stand up and speak. I remember when I first stood up and spoke, I actually went off and was physically sick afterwards. So, you know, it's a really tough thing to do. So thank you so much. Thank you all for your participation, and have a really fabulous evening. Thank you.